emails about installation instructions and followed them. This is amazing. That is the highest ratio of people who've actually done the installs that I've ever had at any tutorial ever. Thank you very much. A couple of spaces at the front, if you like, sir. Maybe there in the second row. So thanks very much. My name is Harry. Thank you for coming. I'm very flattered that this room is so full. I hope you enjoy the session today. I wrote a book about test-driven development called Test-Driven Development with Python. Has anyone here read that? Or parts of it? There you go. If you've read it all, then you know this section is only about parts of the book, so there's some of it's going to be very familiar. This tutorial is going to be about that. Is that a question, sir?
Quick question about the yellow shirt.
Yes.
What's the significance of PyCon UK?
Wear the shirt. I don't have to. This was just the shirt I picked today. I thought I would have one that had UK on it to like represent the UK a little bit for you guys. I did think about it. I had like another conference shirt, but I thought that one was a little bit too show-offy, you know. And this one is like, it's bright yellow, so that brightens up the mood in the room, hopefully. There you go. No. I do have it in the videos as well, if you've seen my videos. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. That's boring. I should have had something else. I'll try and find a different brightly colored t-shirt for the future. Good. Let me give you an outline of what we're going to do today. We're going to cover more or less the materials that I've got in chapter 18 and 19 of my book. And that's about talking about a TDD technique called outside-in TDD. And I'm going to show you how to do that the kind of pragmatic way and how to do it the purest way. And in the purest way, we're going to get into mocks. And we're going to get into trouble with mocks because mocks can be full of trouble. And that'll give us a good worked example of like the pros and cons of mocking and the kind of discipline you have to use with mocking. Mocking is the kind of second part of the tutorial. If the first part goes a little bit slowly, that might be a little rushed. And either way, you can at the end of this tutorial, you can go home and read chapter 18 and 19 of my book, which has all the code that we're going to do today and all the examples and all the explanation. So if you're worried that some of it went a little bit quickly, or maybe I'm going to ask you to do some pair programming during this, and you're like, ugh, we used the other person's laptop. It wasn't my laptop. I'm annoyed. When you get home, you can go home and do all this stuff on your own laptop with detailed instructions. And so that's just to reassure you that there is an opportunity to consolidate your learning by reading a couple of chapters in my book. I don't know if I mentioned, but I've written a book about TDD, which you can get. It's on the internet. It's for free, but you can also buy it if you like. I'm sure my publisher would be very happy with that. And I have a few discount codes for it if you like at the end. So come and see me, and you get 40% off. Yes, I wrote a book. Yes. Good. So today we've got an example application. In the book, I build up a small Django app to illustrate what we're talking about. I chose, as the subject of the Django app, it was going to be a to-do lists app because I have no imagination. And that's the example that everyone uses. And it's the example that everyone uses because it's quite a nice, simple, but database-driven website that can demonstrate all the kind of concepts you might need. So if you've done the checkout and you've got the code in front of you, hands up if you don't have the code for today's session in front of you. Oh, are you sitting next to someone who does? Have you introduced yourself to the person who's next to you? Ask them nicely, do they have the code for today's session? If they don't, you might want to move. Oh, there you go. All right, so I'll give you a very quick tour. So we're building a to-do lists app. And then at the models layer, we've got two Django models. There's a parent class to represent a list, and there's a class to represent the items in a list. So one list can have many different items. So item one, go to the shops. Item two, buy milk. Item three, go back on my spaceship to planet Zog. Whatever it is. The foreign query between lists and items. Does that make sense? The first person, by the way, when I'm going to ask questions from time to time in this tutorial. So if I occasionally go, does that make sense, or is that OK? Please don't do this. If inside your head you're thinking this, right? Like, please ask the question, because if you've got a question in your mind, you're a bit embarrassed and worried about asking it, am I going to betray the fact that I'm stupid? Am I an idiot? You're not an idiot. I've probably gone too fast. There's no such thing as stupid questions. And when you ask that question, I'll bet you anything there's seven other people in the room who had the exact same question, and they're grateful that you did it. So I will give out prizes for stupid questions and for good questions. So please ask them. Any questions? Yes. Yes, yes. Right, so there's two apps. There's lists and accounts. We don't need to worry about the accounts app for today. You can just assume that that works and it does account stuff. Today we're just working on the lists app, and the lists is kind of what contains the representation of our to-do lists. So yeah, this is lists/models.py. This is a simplified version. There's a couple of little helper methods in the actual code, but this is the essence of it. That's the relationship between lists and items. Good question. Thank you, ma'am. You get a prize. There you go. Another question. Yeah. The ones that I sent out by email several times. If you haven't done them, can I just suggest that you move and go and sit next to someone who does? Because it's kind of too late now, and it's not fair to hold up the rest of the room. All right. In the views module, so our models layer represents database object. Who here is not all that familiar with Django? There you go. So when I say things like models, do you know what I mean? Ish? Fine. So very briefly then, models are how Django represents things that are going to go into the database. It gives us a way of working with database entries by using objects and classes, which is a nicer way of doing it than raw SQL statements. So models is how Django thinks about the database. So a list and an item here is going to represent, this items table is going to be a table that has a column that links items to lists, and a column for the actual text of the to-do list item. And the lists table is just a list of unique list IDs, basically. So that's how Django talks to the database. Views, then. Django has a kind of model view controller architecture, but it's not called that. It's called model view, but the view is actually the controllers, and the templates are the views. But the point is, there are three levels. Models is the database level. Views is the kind of in-between level, whose job is to do kind of business logic. These view functions, which are actually controllers, we have one, so the website has a home page. When you log onto the site, you're going to see, OK, welcome to the to-do list site. I think maybe at this point, it'd be quite good to do a brief demo of the website, wouldn't it? So if I go intermediate workshop start, migrate, OK, run server, OK, localhost 8000. When you go to the to-do list website, you're going to see this. The user is welcome. There's a big back box that says, start a new to-do list. If they type in here, they're going to go, oh, OK, go to shops. And then you go, come back. And we could have, like, present good workshop there. How about that? There you go. Enjoy appreciation of students. Great. So I can start a to-do list. Once I've started it, you can notice the URL changes. So on the home page, I was just on the home page. Once I've started a list, I moved to like /list/9. So I'm the 9th person that started a to-do list on this server. And then my list items, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is item 1 for list 9. This is item 2 for list 9, item 3 for list 9, and so on. So that's the basic state of the website. And what we're going to do today is we want to add a new feature to the site. So it's possible to sign in to the website. And I've talked in the previous chapters about how you do sign-in, blah, blah, blah. And we're going to imagine that now you've created this sign-in button, and the users are coming back and saying, hey, I know I can create to-do lists, and I can create multiple to-do lists. So if I go back to the home page, I get a new list. But I would like my list, the list that I've created, to be saved in one place, rather than having to remember the specific URLs of the lists I've created. It'd be nice if when I logged into your website and you knew who I am, my own lists were all presented on one page. So that's what we want to do today. And I'll show you a little bit what that looks like in a minute. So there's our lists. And so if I get checkout chapter 20, migrate. I shall pi migrate. I'm going to load up the website as it should be by the end of today's coding exercise. If these guys load, conference Wi-Fi. I might be better off just switching off the Wi-Fi, to be honest. But yeah, we want to be able to go on here, click on a new page on this website that's going to be called My Lists, and that's going to collect together all of the lists that I've created. So that My List is going to be, hi, Harry, or hi. Users on this website are just identified by their email address. So it's going to be saying, hi, Harry at example.com. These are your lists. There's going to be a list of those lists. That raises the question of, like, how are we going to identify lists? You might identify lists by the first item. So if I have a list that goes, buy milk, buy strawberries, buy blah, 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 that's the buy milk list. If I have another list that says, pack bags, don't forget toothbrush, blah, blah, blah. That's the pack bags list. Yep. Okay. Fine. So that's what we're going to do today. Let me just give you finish off the tour of the code base. Over here. So we've got the home page. This is the view that renders the home page function, the thing that people see. That has a template called home.html, which you'll be able to look at. And it adds the form. So the form for creating a brand new list is called the item form there. So that's a fairly simple view. There's another view which is in charge of new lists. So when you submit that form, that gets sent to this view function. We load up the user's post data, the data they've sent to us, using the item form. The form does some validation. It checks, for example, that the thing you've just created isn't a duplicate or it's not just an empty item. You can't have empty list items. You can't have duplicates. If it's valid, we save a new list object. We call this form.save function, which is going to save a new item onto that list. And we redirect the user back to the page for that list. If there's any problems, we're going to show them the problems back on the home page. So that's the function for creating a new list. This is where any brand new list gets created when a user starts a brand new list. For an existing list, we have this view list view. It has two jobs. One is to fetch the list from the database. And if the user is just, if they're doing a post request, we do one thing. If they're just requesting the page, we render the list template. We take the list object, we pass it to the list template, and that's going to be able to display all the items in the list. If the user is adding a new item to an existing list, so they've looked at that list, they're adding like item 4 and there's already 3 of them, that's request.method equals post. We have a slightly different form that does the same kind of validation. If that's valid, we call save and we redirect back to the list. So there are 3 views. They're just in charge of displaying the home page, starting a brand new list, and displaying or adding to an existing list. So we've said forms lead with validation. They're in list.forms.py. You don't need them until after the break. Login and logout are handled by the accounts module. The lady asked about that. Don't need to worry about that at all today. Are there any questions at this stage about the code? There you go. There's a prize for any questions, so ask the question now. If you're thinking, well, that went a bit quickly, there you go. All right, so just hands up if you just feel a little uneasy. Okay. Can you express why you're uneasy in sort of 2 or 3 words? Right. What have you used, sir?
I use Pylon.
Okay. Yeah. Fine. So compared to Flask, the view functions are very similar to Flask's kind of routing functions. URLs live somewhere else. So instead, where you have that little decorator to say what URL is this view for, that lives in a different file in Django. But it's, you know, it's a way of mapping between URLs and views. And then the models is a little bit like SQL Alchemy, if you've ever used that.
I use it heavily.
Yeah. So you'll find the models are like SQL Alchemy, if anything, a bit simpler. So hopefully that'll be all right. Does the person next to you know Django reasonably well? I'm talking about you, sir. Yeah? So if you have any questions, please talk to each other. What about you over there? So can you express a little bit of your unease? All right. Okay. Yeah. Boy, I know how you feel. I've had quite a lot of coffee today, and, you know, I'm giving a tutorial. Yeah. And what about you, ma'am? Okay. All right, well, so in a minute, I'm going to hand over to you, and you'll get to look around this code in your own time and make sure you get comfortable with it. Sit there and ask your neighbor some questions. Fine. So that's where we are. And then what I really want to do is see if this guy, okay, has loaded. It'd be nice to be signed in and showed you the, not today. Fine. So then what I'm going to teach today, and what I teach in the book, is a technique called double loop TDD. Who knows what that is? There you go. One person in the back, but that's a helper. Does that count? There you go. We can't have that. So I'm just going to explain what that is. And it basically involves having 2 types of tests. So does anyone know what red-green refactor is? OK, could you explain it, sir?
Write the test, watch the test fail, make the test pass.
Yep. And the red and green and refactor?
So it's red fail, yep. Green pass,
yep.
Refactor.
Yeah.
Because you probably made it pass by cheating.
Yeah. That's right. So in general, in TDD, we do the test first, and we write a test that's going to fail because we haven't written the code yet, and that's what we call red. We run the test, and we see it fail. It's very important to see it fail because then you know your test is really testing what you think it is. So I expressed it as a little flow diagram because I spent years as a management consultant, and this is a bad habit I haven't quite shaken off. So we write a test. We run it. Does it pass? Well, if the answer is no, we're in the red phase, we're going to go ahead and write the minimal amount of code that we think is going to address the current test failure. and we go back and run the test again. Does it pass now? Maybe not. We write a little bit more code. We run the test again. Does it pass now? Yes. Once it passes, I think, OK, I've got some code. The test passed. Everything's green. Does my code now need refactoring, either because it's ugly, or because I used some shortcuts, or because I cheated to get it passed? So I do a bit of refactoring, run the test again. If it still passes, I'm happy. I can go back to the beginning. That's the basic kind of unit testing, red-green refactor coding cycle. So that's fine if you just have unit tests in your code. But what I'm demonstrating is a situation where there's functional tests as well as unit tests. A unit test tests like low-level bits of code. They import functions and classes and check that those functions and classes work correctly. Functional tests don't care about functions and classes. They're just testing your application from the point of view of the user. This is a web application, so we're going to use Selenium, which actually pops up a real web browser, goes up and loads the chat app that's running on your development server, clicks on it, and does things like that. So how do the two interact? Essentially, you've got the same thing, but you've got a sort of nice recursive diagram. Yay, recursion. We're programmers. We love that. So we have one big loop on the outside where we write a functional test. We run the functional test. Does it pass? No. If it doesn't pass, we need to like write some application code, the minimal application code. And what that involves is writing a unit test, seeing if it passes. So we have the functional test is looping around the outside. We run it every so often. When it fails, we go, OK, well, now we need to maybe go and write a unit test and get into a unit test code cycle. Once we've got some green unit tests, we go back to our functional test and see if maybe they pass now, or maybe they get a little bit further along, and that prompts us to do a new unit test code cycle. So there's the loop around the outside, the functional tests, you run them less often, and the unit tests, you run them more often. Does that more or less make sense conceptually? OK, fine. So I'm just going to show you a little demo of that for the very first pass of this exercise. What we'd have. So if at any point, by the way, you can't read the text on the slide, or sometimes I'll go into Vim and the color scheme changes randomly because I like to have an exciting color scheme world, and you can't read it, please shout out, Harry, I can't read that, or that was too quick, or that was ugly. OK, so I need my workshop start. And I'm going to go manage.py test my list. OK, fine. So I'm running the functional test, test functional test dot test my list. It's going to log in. It's going to go to the start a new to-do list page. And it's going to fail because it's going to say, I can't find a link there called my list. So you guys have all maybe done the checkout already, and you've run all the unit tests, and you've seen it fails with that error saying, cannot find element by link text my list. You've all seen that. So let's see what's happening there. That's going to fail in our FTs, which are here, test my lists. So on my list test, it has a chunk for creating an authenticated session. So we want this user to be automatically logged in. This is a little cheating function that makes them logged in already. There's create pre-authenticated function. We go to the self.server URL is the homepage of the site. So we're pretending to be a user here. The user and the functional test is written a bit like a user story. Does anyone know what a user story is? Fine. OK, good. Last time I gave this workshop, there was a lot of people going, well, I'm not too sure. Anyway, so this test has got human-readable comments. It describes the story of a user actually interacting with our website. What can they do? They can start to-do lists. They notice for the first time that there's a My Lists page. This is the point at which the FT is failing, or should be on your computers, because we haven't yet even got even a hyperlink for the My Lists page. So I run that FT. I'm going to see it fail if it ever loads. So we'll pretend that it failed there. And that's going to prompt me to go ahead and say, OK, well, to get this functional test to pass, it's failing because it can't even find a My Lists link on the home page. Let me see if I can add one. To do that, I would go up and load one of my templates, the base template. Here are the places where I might keep my hyperlinks. This is the place where the sort of logo for the website is. If the logo is logged in, there's an option to log out. And there's a sort of welcome. This is your email address. If they're not logged in, it says, please sign in. And I'm going to say, OK, well, let's add a new new hyperlink in there. I'm going to have it aligned left. It doesn't need an ID. It doesn't even need an href for now. I'm going to make it go nowhere at all. And it's going to say my lists. All right. So often the functional tests are going to be failing at the user interface layer. And they might drive us to write a little bit of code in our templates. So by doing that, I've at least got a link there. It doesn't go anywhere. But that would give me a chance to rerun my functional tests. They're going to open up the web browser. Now there is a My Lists hyperlink, and the functional test is going to click on that link. It's going to get past that place where it was failing earlier, which is over here. It's going to get past this. It's going to get down here. And here, we're trying to say that the main header on the page should say that this is emails list. So I think our user is called Edith. Your functional test users should always have a name. It makes them human. Edith is not seeing her email address in the header, because at the moment, that my list page goes nowhere. It's still on the same page. And the error that you should see here is edith@example.com, not found in your to-do list. So that would prompt me then to go down to the, so to get this pass part, this part passing, I can't just change templates. I actually have to have a new view and a new URL. And that's the point at which I would go into test views and start a new test class. And this is when we move out of the functional test loop and into the unit test code loop. So list view test, this is going to be the my lists view test. And this is going to test uses the my lists template. Okay, we don't need that. Let's imagine that lists live at list/my lists. And then we're going to say maybe that self.equal response.status code 200. Okay. So this is the first unit test that you might write in today's session. We're going to go and fetch a new URL that doesn't exist yet. We're going to say that that URL should return a 200 status code, and that the URL should render a new template called mylists.html. OK. So I've run the functional tests. I've seen them fail. I've done a little bit of code. The next thing I need to do is I have to write some actual application code, some code in views.py. That causes me to go down to the unit test layer. So I see the unit the functional tests are prompting me to run some unit tests. And the unit tests are going to be, And the way I run them is manage.py test lists. Yes, sir. No. Please don't type at the moment. I'm going to hand over to you in about 5 minutes, and then you can do this in your own time. All right, fine. So this is the first failure I might see. OK, look, you've tried to, so the test framework is saying, you know, this URL you've asked for does not yet exist. There's a 404. I don't want to spend too much longer on this, especially since I've accidentally quit my presentation framework. All right, this is urls.py. I'm going to add a new URL, and it's going to be called my lists. That's going to be view/my lists, and the name is my lists. OK, so my unit test failure is just saying a 404 should be a 200. That's telling me that I don't have the URL it's looking for yet. So the minimal code I can write, and so this is part of the unit test code discipline, is you write the minimal code. The minimal code I think I can write for this is just to go to that urls.py and add an entry. We run the tests again, and it should helpfully tell me what to do. Whoops, attribute error, list.views does not have the attribute my lists. So in my I've tried to use over here a list that doesn't even exist yet. And running the test is what's going to prompt me to write the next piece of code. Views.py, zoop, def my lists, pass. Here's a view that just does nothing. And that's, again, I'm writing the minimal amount of code that's going to address the very specific unit test failure. And now it's saying, OK, views. And so I wrote a view that couldn't possibly work in Django, but it's still got that individual failure moved along to give me a new error. And that new error is saying, oh, OK, your list view doesn't even return an HTTP response. So that's no good. And to fix that, I might nick this code here, pop that down there. We want it to return something. We don't need any context. All right, so I'm deliberately doing this wrong. I'm returning the home template, and I know that I should be doing the my list template instead. But just to show you that the unit test can even tell me to get that right. And by deliberately doing things wrong, I'm checking that unit tests really are testing every single little bit of my code. So that idea of going in tiny little steps is what tells us that our unit tests are granular enough to give us coverage over all the aspects of our code. So home.html is not the right kind of template. So we change that to my lists, and there's my lists. All right, one more test. Fine, so I'm using my list. That's great. Django complains that that template doesn't exist. And so the final thing that we might need to do is touch lists, templates, my lists.html. manage.pytestlist. Hooray. So I could run the functional test again here, and it's going to find itself. It's got to a new page, but there's nothing on it. So basically, at this point, I'm going to go into my template, my lists. Did I do the right thing here? Ah. Here it is. And so I can't just have a blank template. I'm going to borrow something from the lists HTML. I'm going to extend the base template. We're going to have a block content. And I can put an H1 in there that says hi, exclamation mark. All right, so now I've got a real template. It's ready. I've finished my unit tests. All my unit tests are passing. And I can go back to my functional tests again and run them and see if they get a little bit further along. Test my lists. And then as soon as I have an internet connection, this would click on the my lists. It would get a new heading, and it would give you a new error message saying, OK, fine, the string hi is not the right heading for this page. You need the user's email. And that's going to cause me to write some more code. So I'm going to hand over to you guys now and say, you've got the code on your computers. See if you can get this test to actually pass, to get all the way through so that the my list page actually works. It shows the user's lists on there, and the FT gets to the end. And as you're doing it, try and use, you know, so this is optional. I want you to just try and get to the end of that and get working code. But ideally, do test-driven development. So try and write your unit tests first. And so you're going to need a new view, a new URL, a new template, a little bit like what I demonstrated. You're also going to need to have a foreign key relationship between the user model in accounts.models.user and the lists model so that lists can have a relationship with users. And that's how you're going to tie users to their lists. So it's basically a little bit of code in the template, a new view, a new URL, a new relationship in the models, and that should be pretty much what you need. I've got a few hints, e tilde over here. So here's coding challenge one. Oops. There you go. All right. So that's that. Any questions at this stage before you all start coding? There you go. Yes? No, that was someone just scratching their head. But you've attracted attention anyway. Invent a question. Invent a question quickly, sir, and you can win a prize.
Where is this file?
This one with my workshop notes. I don't believe that's publicly available, actually. But I'm going to leave this on the screen for you guys now. Can you read this OK, everyone? Just about? There you go. We have several tutorial assistants. Tutorial assistants, will you identify yourselves? Stand up, guys. There you go. Ba-da-ba-ba. One, two, Trey's not standing up, he's too lazy. One, two, three, four, five, six. That's amazing. Thanks, Mark. Oh, wow. So they're there to ask help. So if you already feel a little bit nervous and have completely got no idea where to start, put your hand up and I'll get you a tutorial assistant straight away. Someone going to help this gentleman here? Okay, good. Who else is feeling like a little bit like they don't know where to start? There you go. Over there. Somebody go and help these people. Over there. There you go. And Jason up here at the front. There you go. All right. Good. How are we doing? 150. Say what? No. There's one thing I forgot. So just before you start, we're doing TDD here. TDD came out of the extreme programming school that was invented in the 90s. And these are guys who said the boring old waterfall development model where we all sit in cubicles and do code after a long requirements gathering exercise is broken. Let's do all the things we really love to do. Let's do testing first, which was an amazing innovation. One of the other things, come on, pay attention. Hey, guys, please, over here. Look at me. All right, good. My ego. I need help. Right. So. They also pioneered pair programming, which is the idea that two people sit at one computer and code together. So that's why I was saying sit next to someone who can fill in the gaps in your knowledge. I want to encourage you to do pair programming today. It will help us get through the workshop faster. If you are the more confident of the pair, you'll have to explain to the other person, and that's going to make sure the knowledge is embedded in your head. If you're the least confident of the pair, you're going to have someone to help you get through this. So I'd really like to ask you, please, to choose one laptop and to make that the primary laptop you're working on today. It doesn't mean you can't do it on the other one, but I just want to make sure that you get through in each pair at least one laptop has got the code working by the end of this session. So make sure, if you haven't already, introduce yourself to your neighbor. Pick one laptop that's going to be the primer laptop. Pick a text editor that you both can use. Make sure you swap who's editing the code. Don't try and inflict Vim on somebody that doesn't know what Vim is. There you go. And if you really absolutely hate the idea, of course you don't have to. I can't force you. But pair programming is what it's all about. All right, fantastic. Okay, so manage.py test. So I'm at the stage here that I sort of demoed for you guys, which is the stage where I've got my new URL, my new template, and everything. And once I've got that running, the functional test is probably telling me, let's disconnect my Wi-Fi. The functional test is going to be telling me, OK, you've got this new template, blah, blah, blah. When I click through to it, it just says hi. So to get that working, I can go back to my template. And I'm going to kind of demonstrate the outside-in steps and path and this concept called programming by wishful thinking, mylist.html. So I'm looking at my list, and I'm saying, OK, fine. My h1 is going to need maybe the user is going to be in there. And I'm going to say, OK, user.email. Or something like that. So that might be my header. And what I'm doing here is I'm kind of programming by wishful thinking, because I'm saying, OK, in my template, I want the user object to already be present. Now, I happen to know that if the user is logged in, every single template already has a user object. But I could also do some wishful thinking here and imagine, like, well, supposing that my lists pages were public. So I can have my list, but I can publish them to the world. And so potentially, I might want to look at other people's lists. So there might be a distinction between the user that's actually logged in and the owner of the particular My Lists page you're looking at, in which case you might have owner.email instead of user.email. Similarly, so I could get that parsing. I won't live code that for you now. By, I think actually it would pass straight away. So then the next stage is saying, oh, fine. Yeah, that should pass at that stage, actually. That'll pass fine. My list, edis@example.com, that's OK. And then it's going to fail, saying, blah, 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 first list, first item has not appeared. So that template is not yet showing all of the user's lists. So again, I can stay up there at the in the sort of UI layer, and I can start thinking, OK, well, how could I have a template that did display the user's lists? I have a for loop. I might have a sort of a UL like this. OK, fine. Yep. I'm going to have a for loop. And so I'm going to start imagining what things would be useful in this template. And I might say, OK, fine, maybe I've got an attribute called my lists that is going to be present in the template. And then I could put li and a little hyperlink, fine, OK. So then I need a hyperlink to go somewhere. And so I've got my list object. How do I get the URL for a particular list? Actually, I happen to know there is already one, so get absolute URL. And that's like this in little curlies. Fine. So that's going to work. And then I'm going to put the list into the hyperlink, and I'm going to name it. And so we said earlier on that lists are named after the first item in the list. So I could have something like list.itemset, which that gives me all of the items in a list, .all.first.text, right? But that's a little bit awkward. And so programming by wishful thinking, let me just finish this off so that it's nice. Yep. I might decide that that's a little bit long-winded. So I'm going to say, OK, you know what? What if like lists magically just had a name attribute? So that's not too bad. And again, I'm going to like say, OK, fine, my lists. I might want to inject a variable into the template magically called my lists. But I might decide, OK, look, I can do a little bit of work. I happen to know that if there's a relationship between users and lists, I can just do user.listset.all. Fine. So I can make decisions in the template that say, OK, what would be convenient for me in the template layer? And that's going to drive the design of the layers beneath you. And this kind of that's this idea of programming by wishful thinking is it's going to force that each code at one layer is justified by the code at the layer above it. And so why is that interesting? Well, it forces you to think about the API of your code before you actually write it. So hopefully your code is going to look nice and be nice to use. It's a little bit the same thing that writing your unit tests first does. When you write a unit test for something, you're also kind of programming by wishful thinking, because you're saying, OK, well, I don't have this method working yet, but if it did, it would be nice like this. So similarly, writing an application outside in from the top layer to the inside justifies each bit of your code by the layer above it. And it avoids this problem where you go, OK, you jump down to the databases layer, and you say, fine, OK, I'm going to need a relationship between users and models. Oh, great. And it might be nice if, on the user object, I could automatically tell whether they have a list or not. So I'll add a special method on users called hasAnyLists. And it'd be great if, list objects could refer back to the owner's email address using a helper method. And you've ever found yourself in a stage where you kind of are at the bottom layer and you're anticipating all of the requirements of the layer above. And then you jump to the layer above and you start writing the code and you realize that you've anticipated them wrong. Like that there's a bunch of stuff you wrote that you just didn't need, or there's a bunch of things that you wrote that now you're actually trying to write the code of the layer above. Turns out you weren't quite right about how you've anticipated your requirements. So outside in avoids those problems, because you program by wishful thinking. You're saying, it would be nice if it were this. Let's imagine it was that, and I can go down to the layer beneath. So that's all well and good, but what happens next? So this user.listset.all is fine. I've got my view. It's in the template. The user is in there. To get this to actually work, I'm going to still need to associate users and lists. So the templates layer is fine. All the unit tests are passing. To actually get, if I run this test, it's all very well. There's a list. But because users and lists aren't associated yet, it's still going to be empty, this page. There's still nothing on there. So what I need to do is I think, OK, well, at the views layer, the thing I need to do is save a relationship between users and list. And the place I do that is in my view that creates a new list. So that's over here. Did it test views? Views.py. Cool. OK. So this function over here that creates a new list object, I basically want to start thinking, OK, well, if the user is logged in, I'm going to do sort of, if the user logged in, I'm going to do something like list.owner equals user, something like that, right? That's the kind of code I want. So I can write a unit test for that. I would go over here in my sort of lists test views. Oops, there it is. So I've got my list tests. This is the list view test to do, and this. So I might have a list over here. I'm going to have a user. Username equals. Okay. I'm going to have self.client. Force login. User. Shoop. I'm going to say, OK, fine, let's imagine logged in users are saved as list owners, something like that. So I do that. I'm going to do my post. That's all fine. And then I'm going to fetch the list equals our list.objects first. All right, so I'm going to go ahead. I'm doing that post, but this time I'm logged in, and I'm going to say, OK, fine, this guy list.owner should be populated, right? Self.cert equal list.owner. And that should be my user. So that would be the kind of unit test I can write at the views layer. I do need to import my user class. So, all right, that looks like a working test. So that's where I've moved down from the template layer into the views layer. I've got a new unit test. I can go ahead and try and run that, manage.py test lists. That's going to fail, fair enough. So username, it's actually email equals, sorry. Never live code anything. Yeah. I'm quite pleased, by the way, if you ever read this book. I don't know if I mentioned that I've written a book about testing. If you read the book, I've made a user class that has exactly one attribute, which is the email, and that is all. And I'm quite proud of that, and I think that all user models should be that, at least by default, until you need anything else. I don't know. All right, fine. List object has no attribute owner. And basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, fine, oops. Fine, to get that passing, I'm going to say, OK, so if user is logged in, that's if the user dot is authenticated, request.user. fine. I can actually write the code over here. Alice.save, fine. Sorry? Yeah, thank you. I spent ages trying to find a good variable name that didn't shadow the built-in list object. List underscore is the best thing. List, list one, list e, my list, all that sort of stuff. Right, list.save. That's probably the worst thing about the book, like that variable name. It might have been the worst thing about writing it. Fine, it still doesn't work, right? I'm never going to get this test to pass until I go down to the models layer and actually implement that foreign key. But that's fine. I could do that, and then rather than live coding the rest of this, I'll show you a few code samples. But so I can go from the template layer to the views layer, I can write some tests, I can write an implementation, but I'm still going to need to go down to the models layer. But finally, by that stage, I know that what I'm doing in the models is really what I need for all the layers above it. So there's my test. Here's the little code that I wrote. Fine, if they're authenticated, we should save them, the owner onto that list, blah, blah, blah. We get that failure, list has no attribute layer. So then we jump down to the models layer, and in testmodels.py, did anyone get as far as writing this to unit test in testmodels.py? No one at all. OK, fine. We can create a user, we can create a list, and then we can start saying that it is at least optional that lists can have an owner attribute. And to get that passing, I set a new foreign key in my models.py, and then Django complains if you don't make it an optional one, and so on and so forth, and you make a migration, but you get there. And so that's the kind of like pragmatic way of doing outside-in TDD. Templates, views layer, and anything that's not going to work at the views layer, go down to the models layer, get that working, and now you should find that your views test pass. But, so that's all very well. Does that kind of make sense? The last thing that we would have to do in this one is actually get the list.name thing working. And that was my programming by wishful thinking. If we want a thing to, list to have a .name attribute, that's going to be a little helper method on the list class like this. But we did kind of cheat, right? Like, so a purist will tell you that if you're doing real strict outside-in TDD, you shouldn't go down to the layer beneath if you've still got failing tests at the views layer. Right, so if I've got tests at the views layer that are failing, I want to try and get them all passing so that I know my views layer is coherent before moving down to the models layer. But that's not possible. It's not possible because you can never associate lists and users unless there's such a relationship in the database. Well, it's not possible using the kind of tests that we're running now, but it is possible if you use mocks. And so mocks is what I want to talk about in the second half of this tutorial. First, we're going to have a break. So in theory, the break is at 3, and it's actually 2:55, so I'm quite pleased with myself for being a little ahead of time. What that means is that probably I've gone a bit too quickly. So we should just spend a minute to make sure there's no questions or anything like that. Am I totally out of shot when I stand up here, Jeff? I bet I am. I'm sorry. Good. So any reactions to that? Like, who is now going, you know what, Harry, I'm totally convinced. All the code that I'm going to write from now on is going to be outside in. Hands up. All right, fantastic. You guys get a prize. Everybody else, these guys are gullible fools. Everybody else is a wise skeptic. So who's feeling like a wise skeptic and is saying, well, I'm not too sure about that, Harry? Who'd like to express it? Yes, sir.
I think our biggest challenge with this method is working with the existing code base.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Can you give an example?
Well, I guess what it comes down to is I can't even begin to write a test like this because if I try to load up this code, it already pulls in all the database and everything like that.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the whole idea of creating that test.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. It sounds to me like what you've got there is you've got a code base without a lot of tests. So the problem is that rather than specifically a problem with outside in. Does that sound right? Yeah?
Sure. I guess the challenge is really like the method's great if you start using the method, but
yeah.
You're going back to work tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah.
How to begin with this?
Oh, yeah. So you can, I mean, like, so if the problem is there's no unit tests and whatnot, obviously, you should try and find ways of adding them, and there are people who will do good talks on how to add unit tests to existing code bases, but I'm not going to do that now in the 2 minutes before the break. You can actually do outside in without tests, right? There was nothing at any point here to stop me from saying, forget all the unit tests. I'm just going to write my template first. Good. When I'm done with that, that template has made some assumptions about what the views should do. So let me go and write the views to do those things. And then those views are never going to work without the models layer, so I'll go to the models layer and implement those things. So even without tests, I've always got the choice of going, right, which file do I edit first? Is it models.py or is it base.html? Which file do I edit second? Is it going to be like views.py or like which direction am I going in? So yeah, so that is possible. Yes, sir?
Does this work for non-web development?
Yeah. Good question. I had at least one person saying, hey, I've got no interest in web development. Should I come to this tutorial? And I said, well, look, I'm a little bit sorry. This book is all about, I mean, that's the main example, so I can't magically not have Django in here. I wonder if that person is here, in which case, if you did come, thank you very much. If you didn't, sorry. I'm watching on the recording over there. Yes. Yeah. So the nice thing about web development is we've got this kind of MVC layer. We've got this layer of kind of like templates and then kind of controller functions and views and then databases. Actually, there's another layer which we'll see after the break, which is the forms layer, which is kind of in charge of validation. And so web applications and Django in particular, I mean, you know, do tend to have these sort of quite nice clear layers. But actually, any application that has a UI is going to have those layers. So if you're building a GUI app, you know, you might not have HTML templates and controller functions that take HTTP requests, but you're still going to have maybe a bunch of code that lays out a UI, and then a bunch of code that reacts to that user's input and goes and maybe does some business logic, or a bunch of code that then saves some state to a database somewhere so other users can access it. And so there's usually a way of thinking of the layers of your architecture and which ones are at the bottom and which ones are at the top, and a way of working outside in. Have you got an example in mind?
I do a lot of ETL work, so I have data that I'm pulling from an API and cleaning and then shoving it into a data.
Yeah. So I wonder what your layers would be in that. Yeah. That's hard to, I can't think off the top of my head. Well, so I guess kind of like you've got at least some boundaries to that, right? So one boundary is the input data, and the other one is the output data. And you've got kind of stuff in the middle. So one way of working outside in would be to go, OK, well, let's try and get the sort of the function that pulls in the input data and changes it from binary data into some dictionaries, maybe. That's kind of one outside. And then going down from that and going to those dictionaries and then like maybe filtering down the values that you do want or don't want or reorganizing them, that's kind of an inner layer. Something like that, maybe, would be a way of making sure you drive the requirements from what you want. Or maybe it's about thinking about it backwards. Like you go, OK, what do I need to input into my final database? Good. To input it from my final database, what data structures would I need to have made? And in order to make those, you know, how do I get the data out of the pipe? I don't know if it's a perfect example, but I think there's maybe ways of thinking about it. One way of doing it is whichever way you instinctively currently build it, try and do it in the opposite way and see if it has any benefits. All right. Yes, sir. Yeah.
We're all talking about is really like three or four different philosophies kind of converging.
Okay.
Right? Like the outside in.
Yeah.
And then kind of wishful coding.
Yeah.
I've heard that concept in from other folks, and it's something that I wish I was integrating more into my coding because I think it's really ideal.
Yeah.
In a really nice way to work. But then also TDD.
Yeah.
Isn't necessarily. Like, when I was first taught TDD, it was very from the bottom.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, no, they are kind of orthogonal. That's right.
Cool.
Yeah.
I guess I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, yeah. I think so. Like I was saying, you can do outside in without tests,
sure.
Right? And similarly, you can do TDD without, certainly you can do unit testing without going outside in. But if you do have this double loop, if you have like functional tests that test your application from the UI layer, from the user's point of view, and you have separately from that unit tests, maybe some tests in the middle, we'll talk about that later, that tends to drive you towards this thing where the functional tests, they care about the UI. And so that tends to lend itself quite naturally to this outside-in philosophy. So unit testing and outside-in are orthogonal, but maybe this kind of double loop thing does lead reasonably naturally to outside-in. The final thing I would say is like I don't always program outside-in. We do quite a lot at work, but we don't always. And sometimes you know, like the instinct is to try and do the building blocks first. And I think particularly if you're not entirely confident in that you're going to be able to succeed in doing the bottom layers, or you maybe using some new API or something you haven't really thought of, that's a time at which you might go ahead and do some experiments at the bottom layer first. But maybe if you're feeling really, really worthy and like you're obeying the testing goat, you would go and do your experiments at the bottom layer and then you would throw them away. And once you're happy that you know what you're doing down there, you would start again outside in. And you might end up with quite different code from what you had in your prototype when you really drew dive the design from the outside in. Good. So after this, we're going to come back. It's 3 o'clock now. We've got until what time do the sessions finish? 4:40, is it? I think so. Good. So let's have 15 minutes. It's 3 o'clock. And then after this, we're going to basically do this kind of thing again, but we're going to use a few mocks to see if we can actually do really purist outside in using mocks. And we're going to immediately run into lots of problems because mocks are error-prone kinds of things. And I want to kind of explore those, and maybe, you know, we all hate mocks, but maybe they have some nice things about them too, and we'll talk about that. Good. I'll be around. If you have any questions in the break, do feel free to ask me. See you guys at 3:15, if that's okay. All right. That's gratifying. Do-do-do. There you go. It's what we do this for. Da-da-da-da. Okay, so before the break, we were just saying that it was quite hard to be a real purist about our outside in. So when we get to that stage where we're needing to do a thing in our views that really requires something from our models layer that's not there yet, there was no way to get that. Or we had a unit test in the views layer that we couldn't get to pass until we did something in the models layer. And so being pragmatic, you might jump down to the models layer, make a quick change, run one more test, one models change, one migration, get that unit test passing, jump back up, get your view test passing, and you're fine. But what if your application was nice? That's fine. This is a simple application. And you know, like that's maybe what I would do in real life. But what if your application was more complicated? What if it wasn't just three layers, templates, views, and models, but what if it was like 6 or 7 layers, right? And what if it wasn't just like one failing test at the in the views layer, but 5 or 6 of them, right? Then maybe it's getting a little bit more nervous, and like maybe you go, okay, fine, I'm going to go, I've got 3 failing tests in the views layer, I'm going to go down one layer. Okay, I've got like 4 now failing unit tests at that layer, which I can't get passing without going to the layer beneath, and so I'm going to go down to that layer, and then, okay, so now you've got like 12 tests all failing, 3 different levels that are all failing, and you're maybe starting to worry that you haven't written your code correctly. So there is a way of getting each layer coherently passing and all the unit tests passing without the dependencies of the layer below, and that is using mocks and mocking. So who here considers themselves like unfamiliar with mocks? Who's not used mocks or not used mocks at all? Fine. So let's hang on. Keep your hands up if you think. 1, 2, 3, 4. So that feels like about 20% of the room. Good. So what I'm going to do is give a brief demo of mocks and show how you might start on a test like that. So who here considers themselves familiar with mocks to the extent that they curse them and also love them? There you go. Fantastic. You, ma'am, would you like to explain a little bit about mocks as soon as you swallowed your delicious pastry? Sorry, I put you on the spot there. just shake your head and say no. I'll ask someone else. But no, if you'd like to explain mocks briefly to anyone, do you feel you could do that?
I'll do my best. I'm not super familiar with them.
Yeah. File operations. Yeah. 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 Good. So you can pretend like you're doing things when you're actually not. The lady here was saying, like, you know, I've got some libraries that do a lot of stuff in the file system. Maybe I don't want to actually do those things to my file system, so I can have use mocks to fake have a fake file system. Does that sound right? Good. Yeah, so that's the idea. A mock is a way of saying, okay, well, my code depends on something over here. And that something might be my models layer, it might be a file system, it might be a third-party API that's going to send emails for you or post tweets. And you say, look, I don't want to use the real thing. I'm going to just have a placeholder that I'm going to use for my test that's going to pretend to be the real thing and use that for my test, and I could get working code that uses a fake version of the thing and tests that use that fake version of the thing. So really, as I'm saying that, that sounds wonderfully abstract, doesn't it? So we would want to see this in kind of practical real life. So that is what mocks are for. What a mock object is it's a magical Python object that has every attribute and every method on it. And so I think the best way of showing that off is in a shell. Oops. La, 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 la. Okay, so test.mock. I can't spell, can I? What's the number one rule of live coding? Never, ever do it. Yeah, exactly. There is one exception to that rule. Like, so I'm breaking it because I'm an idiot. But if was anyone here at PyCon last year that saw Dave Beasley's talk So yeah, fine. Everybody else, if you want to see a video of an amazing talk, look up last year. It was Dave Beasley on, what was it, coroutines and async?
Yeah.
Something like that. Dave Beasley, coroutines and async. And he just sits there with like a terminal screen. He says, well, number one reason for presentation is never do live coding, right? So I've decided to do this with all live code. Yeah. And you're like, oh no, it's going to be terrible. And it was amazing. Like, I've never seen someone type so well, like with so few typos, like some typos, but not many. And just like a black and white shell, like no syntax highlighting, nothing. And he just showed this black and white shell, nothing but live coding, and I never got bored. I never sat there being embarrassed for him while he like made an obvious syntax error, which I'm sure you've, I don't know if you're generous enough to be embarrassed for me, but it's embarrassing. And that's truly masterful, and that's someone who's practiced an awful lot. I've done this a bunch of times, but not as much as Beasley, because I have invested the time to try and develop a good product for you guys. Anyway, so M is a mock object. And so the mock object has every single possible attribute and every single possible property. So m.foo exists. It has an m.foo, m.bar. It also has methods, so like get thing. An m.get thing is a method. It exists. You can just call any method you can imagine. An m.get thing is going to be a thingy. Whoops. Thingy equals m.get thing. And as you can guess, probably every thingy is another mock. So a mock is an object that can have any attribute that you like. Those attributes are all more mocks. You can also call methods which return more mocks. And so you can just keep doing this forever, you know. Thingy.foo.bar.baz. And that's just kind of mocks all the way down. So you've got a magical shape-shifting creature that can be anything that anyone wants it to be. I'm sure there's a good joke to be made here at some point. Maybe about a politician? Okay. I could really make a topical one, couldn't I? I'll do that in a, you know, unless he becomes president, then I'm in trouble. Okay. So, so a mock can have all these actions. So why is that useful? Well, like if I use a mock object to mock out, for example, the requests library, well, the mock requests equals mock, I can have a thing that looks exactly like requests. So I can have mock request.get is going to be a function, and I can call it with like http://blah. And so if I had some code that was trying to call requests and I gave it a mock object instead, that code would still work. It would be able to call methods and it would be able to access attributes on this object. I can also set these things up in advance. So if I go mock.foo equals 2, m.foo equals 2, m.foo. So I could also set up a mock object. It can have every single attribute can be a mock, but I could also override that and set them to be certain values. So I could have, you know, if I'm mocking out a class dog, I have make a mock object, and I'm going to dog.type equals Labrador, and mock dog.name equals Rover, whatever it might be. And then finally, I can also, so I can set attributes in advance, and I can also set methods to return particular things. So m.foo might return, might return a mock, but I might want to say, okay, this mock here is going to have, I'm going to want it to set up in advance so that if you call m.bar, I want it to return a particular value, and you can do that like this. Return value is a special attribute on a mock. There you go. And so now if I call, m.bar, I get 3 instead. So I can take a mock that by default has every attribute and every method that returns more mocks, and I can give it specific properties that I might need in my test. So that's mocks. They're kind of magical, right? So let's see them in real life with an acronym, but you maybe can't imagine quite how to use that. Let's see an actual application of it. So we've got test views. Good. All right. So here's my test at the moment that is trying to say, OK, fine, the list owner should be saved if the user is authenticated. And when I try and run that, test lists, at the moment it's saying it's not working. List has no attribute owner. And that's because, should we have a change of color scheme? Yay. Good. Is that horrible? I mean, you can say you can't read that. There you go. Great. It's a bit too high. Everyone, this is Monokai. Everyone's got that, right? Let's change again. Good. That's better. So I'm going to start writing this code over here that says, OK, fine, right, well. So the test fails. It's saying list has no attribute owner. So let's imagine trying to get that test to pass. Owner equals request.user. List.save. I can do that all I want, and that's still not going to work because I haven't got the lower level stuff. Okay, so let's leave these out for now. How do I rewrite that test in such a way that it doesn't need the database layer? Well, I use a mock, and I can import from unit test. Unit test or mock import patch. So the mock class lives in unittest.mock. That's in Python 3. In Python 2, it's its own module. And then there's a magical method called patch, or function called patch. And I can use patch as a decorator at patch over here. So what patch does is I'm going to say lists.views.list. mock list class. All right, fine. So what's going on here? The patch decorator says, all right, I want you to go in and patch inside the list.views module. I want you to patch out the list, the object in there called list. And then the app patch decorator is going to inject a mock version of that into your test as mock list class. So what that's doing is it's saying, OK, for the duration of this test, list.views.list, instead of being the normal list class, is going to be a mock object. And so when I run this code over here, when I try and do list.objects.create, instead of getting a real list object that is talking to the database, I'm going to get a mock object. So that's the match. That's the magic of patch. In the Ruby community, they would call that monkey patching. We just say patching. And this is the power of Python, which is that while you're running code, you can go in and go and mess about with things that are in other modules and change them and all sorts of things. And you could even do this manually if you wanted to. Like, so you don't have to use the patch decorator. You could import, in this code here, I could do import views, and I could do views.list, which is currently the list class, and I could actually reassign that before running my code. So it's just syntactic sugar. Because of the magic of Python, you can change things at runtime. That's what it's all about. So I've got a mock list class. And so instead of doing this sort of client force login, fine, that's fine.
Hey, Harry.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, sir.
So the mock list class
yes.
is available that contains the mock?
That is the mock, yeah. So when, and I'll show you, mock list class. So this is the mock list class is going to be, when I run this test and this code runs, that's going to be this object here, which instead of being the real list class, is going to be a fake version of the list class. And I can say the mock list class dot objects dot create, which is the function I'm calling in the test, is going to return something. And I'm going to say that is going to be a mock list. So now I'm giving myself access to this variable over here, list. When I call list dot objects dot create, I'm going to get, instead of my normal list object, I'm going to get a mock object. And I can basically, over in my test, I can make assertions about the mock list instead of the real list. Da-da-da-da. So that's how I transform my test from being a test that uses the real list object and talks to the real database into a test that talks to a fake version of the list class and talks to a mock version of those list objects. And it should allow me to make assertions about what that code is doing without needing the real database and the real list class. So, should we try running it? What do you think will happen? Well, let's find out. Da, da, da. Test list. Zip. Okay, so this is problem number one with mocks, is that once you start mocking, sometimes you can't stop for a little while. So it's saying, cannot assign magic mock name equals list.objects.create. Item.list must be a list instance. And if I look what's happening, it's gone like right at the top of my traceback here, I've got form.save, right? What's happening over here is I've changed my list object from being a real list into being a mock list. And that's fine, but when I get down here to form.save, my form is expecting a real list object. So when I gave it a mock list object, it's going, oh, hey, that doesn't look like a real database thing. I can't work with this. So now I've got two choices. Either I can change my mock back into being a real list object, so I just mock out the list class, but list.objects.create could return a real list, or I'm going to say, right, fine. If the form is giving me trouble, then I guess I'm going to have to mock out the form as well. Fine, okay. So we're going to go here. We've patched views.list, and we're going to patch views.item form. And this is going to come mock item form. Good. Try that again. And now it's happy. So what's happened now? Well, it's happy in the scene. The specific error that was happening before has gone away. So now I've said not only is list a fake list, but also the item form here at line number 14, I guess, is a fake version of the item form. So that means that form.save is no longer going to complain. So I've had to mock out not just one thing, but two things. But the one I really care about is this list.objects.create. So okay, fine. Now the test is running without any unexpected failures. And the failure now is saying that the basically list.owner is not the user that I expect it to be. And I can actually now get that to pass. So let me just show that again, because that was a bit quick. So the error here is saying, blah, 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 mock object, which is the name is list.objects.create, return value, dot owner is not user object. So if that's not quite clear, we can have a look. It's at line 85 in the test. And that's over here. So it's this one here. It's saying it doesn't look like you've correctly assigned the owner like we want it to. So let's try doing that in our views. Doodly-doo. I'm going to go list. score.owner equals request.user. All right, so that's the simplest. That was a bit quick for you guys. All right, so I'm now assigning the owner correctly on the list object, rerun the test, and it passes. All right, so who can see a possible problem with this? Yes? Say that, sorry, I'm a bit louder. Yeah, yeah.
So you're going to have to
Yes, I think that's true. So by default, mock attributes are truthy. So mock.foo is another mock, and a mock is a truthy thing. So form.isValid is going to return a mock, and that's going to be true. So at the moment, I'm in the true case. That's correct. So I could be thinking about, okay, well, if we're mocking out the item form, I should probably do the false case. But that is not the main problem we have now. Yeah. Yeah. Well, so you're quite right that at the moment, I still do eventually need to implement that models layer code. But I do have more code than I did before, right? What I'm trying to say is, okay, look. I made a test, so I wanted to test that my list was assigning the owner attribute to the list I've created correctly, right? And so I've written that, I couldn't get that passing before until I had the models there. Now I've used mocks, I can actually write that code and I can get a test that used to fail that passes and that justifies this line of code. So do I now have code that's correct in my view function? That's my question. Do you think maybe that this is missing, right? So that's what the mock's not telling me, is that unless I call save, That list.owner assignment is never going into the database. So I actually need another mock or another assertion in my test, which is to check that I've actually called save. So that's what I'm going to hand over to you guys to do, is to grab the code from a little checkout, use the patch method, mock out the list class, and do not just the first mock that I showed you, which checks that the owner is assigned, but also a second mock that checks that we've actually called save on it. And for bonus points, you can also, so that would, you know, having a test that checks that we've called save on the mock is one thing. You also maybe, for bonus points, check that you haven't accidentally done this and called save before you've assigned the owner. So the challenge number one is, well, challenge number one is create some unit tests which have some mocks in. Challenge number two is get them passing. Challenge number three is add the test for the owner and the saving. Challenge number four, check that they're done in the correct order. And I think that is in my notes. Live demo of mocks. And I think this is your instructions. Right. Good. So you can do a git checkout. So whatever you have in your git repository at the moment, either do a git stash or a git commit to save it away, git add dot, git commit, whatever, and then do a git checkout of this alternative branch intermediate workshop part 2. If you're using Chrome, there's an intermediate workshop part 2 dash Chrome driver. And your objective is to basically start with the code I just demonstrated, create or change the existing test that you list owners are saved to use mocks and check that not only the owner is assigned, but the list.save is called. Good. Any questions at this point? Anybody that feels that they can't really go ahead with this without a few questions being answered? All right. So hands up if you feel totally lost and you're not too sure where to start. There you go. All right, over there. Can I get a helper over in that corner? And one over here. There you go. Ba-da-ba-ba. Who have we got? There you go. You guys. There you go. Anna, do you have a minute to come over here? Or oh, any one of you three, really. Mm-hmm. All right, fine. Good stuff. All right, hands up if you need a little help. There you go. You, sir, you ask if you need something. There you go. Fine. There you are. On camera there. So hands up if you got to the end of that and you're like, hooray, I managed to get a new patch and I got the patch the item form and I managed to make an assertion about not only the user but also the save should being called. So hands up if you got at least that. Yeah, there's a couple of hands. All right, fantastic. Who went down to the next layer and got the models working and, you know, managed to get the FT passing and all the way to the end? Didn't think so. You know, to be fair, we like had 40 minutes before and you know, sort of 12 minutes now, so that wasn't really going to happen. And hands up if you managed to make assertions on the save being called. And hands up if you managed to figure out how to assert that save was called after assigning the owner. Ooh, how did you do that? Side effects, absolutely. OK, so for anybody that doesn't know what side effects are, I have some demos I prepared earlier. OK, so who's found working with mocks quite confusing? There you go. Well, you know, working with mocks is quite confusing. You can very quickly lose track of what's what and what's where. So you pay a big penalty in the kind of mental effort you have to make with your tests. And it gets worse. For the people who, just with the mock example I showed earlier, we mock out one thing, we found we had to mock out two things. And once we'd mocked out those two things, I can mention to you, hang on a minute, you need to remember to actually call save in the right order. So if you strictly want to make a really good, this is the kind of test you can end up with, right? That you're going to have a mock that's going to return a real instance of a list, because that's one way of solving that form problem. And then to be able to check that the owner is assigned, I'm going to create a little throwaway function that does an assertion. I assign it as a side effect of the mock save function, and then I can check that the when the mock save function gets called, it's going to make some assertions about the order in which things happened. Now, compare this to the test we had before that just said, log in, call the view, does the list in the database have an owner? Compare it with this thing that's now about 25 lines of code. You've got a horrible test here. So you're maybe starting to think, like, hang on, is this really worth it? Like, working with all these mocks just for, you know, in order to be a purist and be able to get down and get all passing tests at the views layer before I go to the models layer, it's feeling increasingly not worthwhile. And I would agree with you, right? This is a lot of effort to go to, and it's an ugly test. And, you know, when you could just be pragmatic, leave one failing unit test. But, you know, we're also imagining a more complicated architecture where there are lots and lots of levels. So let's imagine we really do want to force ourselves to use mocks for some reason that we can justify. Is there any kind of silver lining? I think there is. So one of the things that you can do when you've got a horrible test like this with horrible mocks and it's a big fat mess is you can go, oh, well, that's tough. That's what you get with mocks, a horrible fat mess. But there is actually something else you can do, which is think, are my tests trying to tell me something? Like, why is this so hard? Is it so hard just because of mocks? Or is it also hard because my code isn't as nice as it could be? Look at this new list function, right? All this function is supposed to do is create a new list object if a form is valid, right? But I've ended up with like 10 lines of code here. Like, I create a form, I create a list object, I do this if, I save it, I do a redirect, I do another if the form is not valid, I do something else. Like, it does seem like there's a lot of complexity here. And that's maybe why my tests are so complex, right? What if my actual implementation of the views function was a little bit simpler? What if it was really stripped down to its bare minimum, which is that I create a form, if the form is valid, I ask the form to save, and I pass the form, the request.user, and I redirect, and otherwise, I render my home page. So the view is just doing the minimal effort. It creates a form, it passes the form some information that the user gave it, and it makes one decision. Right, so my view makes one decision about whether the form is valid or not, and the rest of the job is up to the form. So I can push the complexity out of the view and down to the form. And if I had a view that was simple like this, then the test for it would be much simpler. I just need to mock one class out, which is the form class, and just to say, okay, in the case where it's going to be valid, I want to check that the form.save was called once with the request user. And so, but now, instead of having a sort of 14-line kind of mocky test, I have a 5-line mocky test that's much more straightforward. But I can only do that by simplifying my views. And my views used to have multiple collaborators. It was collaborating with the list. Collaborators is a bit of a technical term in object orientation. But the view function depends on the list class and the form. And I've changed that so it only depends on one thing, just the form. So I've simplified my architecture. And so, you know, OK, I might use mocks all the way. And so like that might, if you use mocks all the way through all your tests for your views, then they end up being, okay, what's the view's job? It should pass pose data, it should call form save, it shouldn't save if we're invalid, and it should redirect if we're valid, and it should render the home page if we're not valid. So that really describes the views completely. And these can be entirely mocket tests that never touch the database. But then I get down to the forms layer. I'm saying, fine, okay, let's push the complexity down to the forms layer. And actually, I've just moved my problem a little bit. Right, and so now I've got this code over here that I'm going to need to be able to save. And I'm going to look, and so my view is passed to the form. It's passed an owner object. I need to go and check whether that owner is authenticated. And if they are, I'm going to create a list object, and then I'm going to create an item object, and I'm going to assign, you know, the sort of text. It's quite long, but you know, it's not too complicated. So this doesn't feel too bad, right? Well, let's start trying to write some tests for that. So similarly, I'm going to use mocks because I don't want to go down to the database layer yet. And I find myself mocking out the list class and the item class. I'm going to say that the user is a mock as well. And then again, I'm going to have this weird side effect formulation because I need to check that when I call save on the list, I have already assigned the user if I needed to. And like again, I've ended up with this sort of really ugly kind of mocky test. And again, I might throw up my arms and say, ah, you know, that's mocks. Or I might say, maybe again, the tests are trying to tell me something. And they're trying to tell me, look, I've again got like some forms code that has loads of different collaborators. And maybe again, this is another opportunity to think, what if the world were a better place? Let's go back to, again, like programming by wishful thinking. What if we had something like this? Like the complex job of create, like so the complexity here is the form was having to create a list object and an item object. So the form had to understand quite a lot of stuff about the database and how it works, like lists and items are related by foreign key and so on. So maybe if I tell the form, look, don't worry about that. Don't worry about this database layer stuff. Just worry about your stuff. And your stuff is, you need to make a decision about what to do. If the owner is authenticated, you should do one thing. If the owner is not authenticated, you should do another thing. And we'll let the database layer worry about, you know, creating database objects. So all the new list form should do is, I'm going to imagine I've got a magical new function on the list class called create new that just takes what the new item text is, and maybe optionally it takes an owner. So I can push that down. Now my new list form is much simpler, and my tests for my form become much simpler as well. And then finally, I get down to the models layer, and I'm going to make a helper function. And at that layer, I'm OK to not use mocks anymore. Because now that I'm down at the models layer, the whole point of the models layer is to do database stuff. So I may as well have tests that use the real database. So that's the theory. Now, I was thinking about a tutorial in which I made you guys go through every single one of these steps. I think we get just about as much out of it by just showing it. So that's the theory. Now, one thing you might tell yourself is, you know what? Why did I have to go through all these horrible mocks? I mean, it's still quite a lot of work, right? You make an ugly mocky test. That's quite a lot of work. Then you decide, actually, you need to refactor it. So you have to make a different version of the mocky test that's simpler. Then you need to actually refactor your code. And then you need to jump through two or three more layers. It's quite a lot of work there. And you might think to yourself, you know what? If I just use non-mocky tests, I can still do all this stuff. The end result is the same. The things that get created in the database are the same. So it seems like kind of a long way to get here. And maybe I would have got here without using all these mocks, but maybe I didn't. Like, the first time I wrote that code, I was totally happy with my view that had 8 lines of code. Clean code is something you have to strive for. If you're really disciplined, you're going to do it anyway. But maybe having, like, if you're using a lot of mocks, they might help point you towards that clean code and give you kind of feedback on your design, which you wouldn't otherwise get. So that's the possible silver lining of using mocks, is that they're going to give you better feedback on your design. So the next thing I want you guys to do is check out this intermediate workshop part 3, right? And that's a stage I'm going to kind of show you, but you guys can do it at the same time. Okay, git stash, git checkout, intermediate workshop part 3. Okay. Test views, load, good. So what is it? New list view, fine. So these are my tests. We save the form. Here are my tests for the redirect. Test forms. In the forms, I've similarly got some mocky tests that mock out my list.createNew function. Models. I've made this new kind of static method here on the list function that does the hard work of creating a list object and an item object. So now the work is done in the database. And at this stage, you should find that Python manage.py test lists all passes, right? So all my unit tests are passing. I've got some code that looks pretty much right. This thing over here knows how to create an object in the database, and it knows how to optionally add an owner. The forms.py are doing the right thing, where if the owner is authenticated, we create new and pass the owner in. If it's not, we create new without an owner. And finally, the views are just instantiating the form, telling the form to do the saving, and doing the hard work. So all the unit tests are passing, and the code looks just about right. So fantastic. Does my functional test pass? Let's take a look. Not found. Server error 500. So your next challenge, which I'd like you to spend sort of 5 minutes on, is see if you can figure out why this is broken. Like, what is going on here? All the tests pass. We've got a lovely new architecture that's really clean and simple, right? Every single, like, the views code is now minimal, the forms code is minimal, the models code, and each one is doing the right kind of work. So my lovely mocks have driven me towards a lovely architecture, but things are broken. This, by the way, is a little argument for why you need functional tests. All my unit tests were fine, and everything I could think of is passing just fine. But something is wrong. There you go. So take a look around the code and see if you can figure out what's wrong. As soon as you figure it out, shout it out, and you win a prize. I'm sure you can. The problem is not in urls.py. No biscuit. No biscuit. So the hint is that the functional test fails with a big traceback, but you can also see the output from the server. So when that server error 500 happens, there's probably some sort of error in the code that's causing that 500, and that's probably in a traceback here, and that might help you nail down the location of the problem. Yeah, if you want to win the prize. I think you're on the right path, almost. So if you can tell me what the actual missing piece of code is, or the actual piece of code that has a bug, you get the prize. Say what? Sid? There you go. So why is that a problem? Yeah. Yeah. Okay, do you feel you can explain that to everyone?
Like, I mean, you mock up everything and then you send the mock back up to Django for the template to render.
Yeah.
The template is trying to look for a, I believe you either had a list of a list to show or something like that.
Yeah. What do you?
No.
So the when you run the real code, there's no mocks involved. So the tests are incomplete, but there's a real bug in the code. So the problem is not the mocks per se. The problem is there's an actual bug in the code, and I think you're on the right track. So what is it? Exactly. So let me. So well done. You get a prize. Come and claim it in a minute. All right. So the answer is this. In our view, we're calling form.save, and we expect form.save to return the new list object. And we say redirect list. So this Django will redirect to the page that represents that list. So we need form.save to return a list object. Now, if I go and have a look in the forms code, this function save is not returning anything at all. Right? So I've checked, my tests are correct. They've checked that I've called create new successfully in both of these cases, but what they haven't checked is that I'm returning this object here. So I'm expecting to return the object that I get from doing list.create new. And so similarly, there's another assumption there, which is list.create new should return a list object. And that's over here. And so this should be doing return list as well. All right. So that's what I need to do to actually get my code working. If I do that, and I run the functional test again, with a bit of luck, demo gods, please. It doesn't quite work because we haven't made the list.name attribute. But this is the expected failure, so it gets passed. There's no more errors. So the problem is that I made a bunch of mocks that checked a bunch of things about my code, and the code did those things correctly. But what doesn't happen, or what mocks aren't checking, is that all my code is glued together correctly. So I was kind of almost right in all of my code. I was doing the right things, but I had forgotten this little thing here, which is absolutely critical. So the models layer was kind of doing the right job, except it wasn't doing the job completely that the layer above it expected. And similarly, the forms layer was doing the, well, it was doing kind of the right logic. It had the right if statements. It was passing the right functions, the right arguments. But again, it forgot to return the object that the views layer was expecting. And what this is about is it's about what we, the term for this is implicit contracts, basically. Well, as soon as I write a code that looks like this, list equals form.save, I'm having an implicit contract here, as I'm saying, right, well, when I have this kind of code, I'm expecting form.save to return an object. And so when you do, essentially, so what's the solution to that? It's like whenever you say test passes to you, whenever I write a test that says my response should be the redirect's return value, and the redirect, probably haven't even got it here. Mock redirect, yeah. So the this one over here, line 122, the redirect should be called with the return value from form.save. When I write that test, I need to be mentally identifying the implicit contract here. I need to say, okay, well, this layer here has got an implicit contract with the layer below, which is the form.save needs to return a list object. And so, you know, if you're writing mocky tests, you need this discipline of identifying implicit contracts. And one way of remembering this is you might go ahead and write a placeholder test. So while you're finishing your test views.py, you might have to jump down into test forms.py and put a little placeholder saying, assert form.save should return a real list object. And that's quite a lot of mental effort. The alternative is to say that we do have the functional tests. The functional test failed. They told us there was a problem, and we did eventually nail down what the problem was. But so this is why mocky tests on their own are error-prone. Because you need that discipline, which is quite hard to remember, you need to be thinking about implicit contracts. If you run just unit tests and you only have unit tests, you need to be very, very disciplined and very, very smart. And I can be disciplined sometimes, and I can be reasonably smart sometimes, but I can't be disciplined and smart all the time. And that's why, by having a functional test, I save myself from having to be smart all the time. And it's going to be able to identify problems like that for me. So the message I'm trying to convey there is that mocky tests are hard work. They can give you good design feedback, and there's other reasons that they're good. They give you faster tests and things like that. But they do require a lot of discipline. And if you can't rely on having that discipline all the time, you are going to need these functional tests to catch your errors for you. So the kind of conclusion, oh, wow, I'm kind of early, really. The conclusion I'm trying to reach is you've kind of got three different types of tests that we've talked about today. We've got our functional tests, and the functional tests are the ones that saved us at the end of the day today. They're the ones that told us, you know, you think you've got everything working, but you've actually failed to glue it all together correctly. So the functional tests that actually test the application from the point of view of your user, that test your application like it's a black box, are the ones that really tell you, actually, does it work or not? Does it work or not from the point of view of the user? The mocky tests that we wrote, they're the hardest to write, but they're also some of the ones that give you the best design feedback, the ones that push you towards a nice architecture. And they run nice and quick. So there's, you know, we've built a little to-do list app, and all the tests run in whatever it is, like 0.8 seconds. If you have a big, complicated application, things take a lot longer. And isolated tests are tests that don't touch the database, tests that don't touch the file system, and things like that, run a lot faster than a test that does have to touch the database. And in between, we've got these integrated tests. So in part one of this workshop, where we just used the Django test client, and we had our kind of pragmatic test, and we couldn't get it passing until we went down to the models layer, those view-level tests actually do create real objects in the database. And so they're what we call integrated tests, because they rely on all the layers working at the same time. And the thing about them is they're quick to write, and they're easy to understand. Like the tests that we wrote at the beginning of the day, even though it's a little hard work, they're much easier to understand than those mocky tests, even the nice mocky tests. But on the other hand, those tests will also tell us when we forget to return a value, because if I forget to return the value from my helper function, then the object wouldn't get created in the database, and the test would give me an error. So they're kind of like in between each other, aren't they? You can see there's a sort of sliding scale, where the functional tests tell you that everything really is glued together. The integrated tests will tell you, give you a bit more feedback when you forget to glue things together. And the mocky tests won't give you that feedback about integration, but they will give you that feedback about design. And the point on timing is an important one, because like it might seem now that, fine, the mocky tests would run in like, you know, a few milliseconds, and then the databasey ones will still run in 0.1 seconds instead of 0.01. But at Python Anywhere, where I work, we have a unit test suite, and by unit tests, I mean like Django-y integrated tests, that takes about 45 minutes to run the whole thing. And the functional test suite takes about 16 hours. Now, not everyone is Python anywhere, right? Like, so our test suite needs to start up about 12 different servers on AWS as like step number one. And that takes about an hour. And so I don't expect anybody else to be sitting around here telling me about their 16-hour test suite for a fairly normal Django application. But you know, if you end up having a one-to-one ratio between unit tests and functional tests, the functional tests are going to take an awful lot of time to run. And then you might find yourself looking for excuses not to run them all. And that's dangerous, too. Good. So that's really like a starting point for discussion. Any reactions to that? Any questions or comments or suggestions? Any like, do you feel like my talking about how the mocky, like, so the mocky unit tests, do you feel like they're just horrible? Or do you feel like maybe the silver lining of design feedback and faster running tests might occasionally be worth it? Have I convinced anyone that maybe mocky tests aren't all evil? Yes, Kojo. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I think that is genuinely true. Like, I'm whether.
If you're not working to remove them.
Yeah? Sorry?
If you're not working to get rid of mocks,
they're probably lying to you. If you're not working to remove mocks, they're probably lying to you. Yeah. 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 I think that's a good rule of thumb, right? Like, if you've actually got a piece of code and you've had to have three mocks, that means your code is probably too complicated. And even though complicated code might still be correct, you'll probably find that your tests aren't really telling you anything that useful anymore. That's a good point. Yes, sir? Oh, that already is the case. So Django's test runner will use an in-memory SQLite database instead of the real database. But even that is still quite slow. So the ultimate proponent of this, whose work I definitely recommend, is a chap called Gary Bernhardt. And Gary Bernhardt, like, so there's a bit of a big discussion about TDD about a year ago. And people were saying, you know, all these mocks, they don't test anything properly, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, like, just use the database. Like, the in-memory Django database is pretty quick. And Gary Bernhardt said, listen, I type at 190 words per minute. I run my tests by pressing the Enter key, so I run them several times a minute. When I'm running my tests, they run in a side pane to my Vim. So I want to be able to, like, run the tests and be able to flick my eyes over to the right without even stopping my workflow at all and see an expected failure or an expected pass and go straight back to writing code. I am not interested in waiting for a test suite for any more than about 0.2 seconds. Right? So that's the kind of requirement you might have of a really, really fast suite of unit tests. I don't think anyone on Earth types at 190 words per minute apart from Gary Bernhardt. But maybe if your workflow really is like running the test, look, run the test, look, run the test, look, you can't be sitting around even waiting for an in-memory SQLite database is too much time. Because like any Django test that loads up the whole of the Django stack and all the middleware and so on, it's already 10 times slower than a test that just tests one function without even loading Django. And so you might, this is the reason that some people, if you really follow this philosophy of pushing the complexity down, of like taking all pushing the complexity down to the models layer and making the models layer entirely in charge of database stuff, you eventually, like the holy grail of that is to try and have an application that has your business logic being like the kind of rules and decisions that you need to make about the things your users do and what state you're going to store, be totally independent of your UI and totally independent of your backend and storage and file systems. And so you could have almost a purely functional system that doesn't import Django at all. It just makes decisions. It just has ifs and for loops and things like that. And the tests for that can run at like, you know, nanosecond speed. But you know, that's something that you have to work quite hard at in architecting it. I recommend Gary's talks, Fast Test, Slow Test, and Functional Core Imperative Shell. If you're interested, there's lots of links to further reading about these topics in my book, which I'm not sure if I've mentioned, but I've written a book. Yeah, there's like less and less laughter for that joke as the time goes on, isn't there? Yeah. Yeah, so there's at the end of chapter 19, which is the one we just did, there's some links to further information. Also, chapter 21 has this kind of recap of discussions of like different types of tests, pros and cons of functional versus integrated versus unit tests, and links to other smarter people than me discussing it on the internet. Yes, yes, sir. Yeah. 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 Yes. 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 Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. How do I figure out? Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't have a good answer to that. So the gentleman there is referring to a thing called the test pyramid, which says if you split up your tests, you know, kind of more or less, into the top level tests, which we're calling functional tests here. Some people will call them acceptance tests or end-to-end tests. But one way or another, the things that kind of like really work with your real application and check that it really does work. And the bottom level tests, the most granular ones, the lowest level ones, the fastest ones, maybe the ones with the most mocks, the kind of true unit tests. There are also maybe some tests in between. And the supposed ideal that you're to reach for is that you have a lot of low level tests that run very fast, fewer kind of middle level integration tests, and like even fewer functional tests. So you have a functional test suite that just has the minimal number of tests to reassure you that your application works and that it's all glued together correctly. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. 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 So there's definitely zero mocks up here. There's probably quite a lot of mocks down here. And here, well, there might be none or there might be a few. It kind of depends what you're doing. So like in Django, these are the integrated tests that you get encouraged to write, which, I mean, they're very pragmatic. I think you can write a reasonably like big Django application, which does basically, like Django applications, the thing is that often they're just a fairly thin wrapper around a database. It's just a UI around a database. And for that, you probably don't need to be really clever about your architecture and like split it down into 15 layers of hexagonal pattern and have a beautiful, you know, 5 layers of mocky tests and whatnot. I think, you know, just a bunch of integrated tests is probably fine and they probably run fast enough as long as you're not Gary Bernhardt. You know, fine, my tests take 3 seconds. Okay, I'm happy. My tests take 20 seconds. You know, that's fine. It's when your tests start to take, you know, 10 minutes and you're like, oh, now I need to go and make coffee just to find out if my application is broken or not. That's when you start to worry maybe about this pyramid. And I don't have a good answer to figuring out how do I evolve to getting the exact correct balance between unit tests and functional tests and integrated tests, partially because it varies from place to place. So like I was saying, like a simple CRUD Django app is one thing. Python anywhere where I work is a very different thing where, you know, like my real test suite has to actually start like 12 different servers on AWS and configure all of them and install a database on them and make sure that they all know about each other and have a DNS set up correctly. And like, you know, each individual test is like clicking through the UI, but what happens at the back end of that is that the UI will create a user account which mounts a file system from a file server, so I need to check that, you know, NFS is set up correctly, and then it's going to start a real process, and that's reliant on all the sandboxing and Docker code running correctly, and it's going to need the mounting of the user's home drive in. Like, so the thing that's happening in the back end is very complicated, so I need a lot of tests to really reassure myself that stuff works, and that's how we end up with a functional test suite that lasts 16 hours. That's not to say that we couldn't be clever and have move some of our tests that are in functional at the moment into an integration layer somehow, but we haven't yet found a good way of doing that. Yeah, but I think that the way you answer that question is by thinking, like, what are my tests for? Like, what are my tests doing for me? Like, I want them to tell me if my application works or not so that I don't deploy broken code to my users. I want them to help me write code as fast as possible, so I want them to run quickly. And I want them to give me feedback on my design. I want them to help me write an application that's easy to work with, easy to maintain, easy to refactor, that has a nice architecture. And different types of tests do those jobs in different ways. And so it's about whenever you write that test, saying, like, what is this test for? Is it giving me good feedback on that? If you end up with a load of mocky tests that don't really end up catching bugs, right? Like, you have to ask yourself, like, I've put a lot of work in making tests that have loads of mocks. Is this just make work? Is it actually helping me write correct code? Or would I be better off throwing away a bunch of these and just using some integrated tests that would actually tell me whether something is broken or not quicker? Like, how quick are the feedback cycles? And it's, you know, everyone wants to pronounce universal rules on this. Like, the testing pyramid is someone's attempt at a universal rule. It doesn't apply to, I don't think it works well at Python anywhere. It might work well for you. And I don't, you know, it's dangerous to say there's universal rules here. It really is. But I think it's fairly universal to say functional tests do this better and unit tests do that better, and that will help me think about which ones I need more or less of. Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments or reactions? There you go. All right. Are you going to tell me that I've actually finished a tutorial like 60 seconds early? That's amazing. Well, listen, guys, so this is only the third time that I've run this tutorial. I ran it once, I changed it completely. I ran it a second time, which is more or less like this. This is the third time. I'm sure it still needs quite a lot of improvement. I've got some ideas about what I might change, but I really need your feedback. So please drop me an email. You can find out all about me because I have a website, obeythetestinggoat.com, which is, where's that gone? Here we go. The end. Let's make that bigger. All right, so I have a website, obeythetestinggoat.com, where you can find out about a book. I don't know if I've mentioned about a book. There's also a discount code for it. So I said there were prizes. That is the prize. That is the discount code if you don't want to buy the book. There's 40% off there, off my book. And I suspect many other books in the O'Reilly store use the same code. I don't tell anyone. Thank you very much. Make sure you send me feedback. So come and grab, you can find my email addresses all over the website and all over the internet. So by all means, email me about it. I'm sure I've emailed you guys in the class notes several times, so you know how to find me. Please send me an email. The organizers will also send you a feedback form. It's really important you feed that out, because having been on the committee that decides what tutorials to have, feedback from previous years is really, really important. It helps us to schedule good tutorials and not bad ones. So, make sure you tell them how bad this was so they don't let me do it again. So feedback for me, feedback for the organizers. Thank you so much for coming. And have a lovely afternoon. Enjoy the conference. I've got to go home tomorrow. But you guys have a wonderful week. And thank you very much for coming. I really appreciate it.